Very good evening to all of you. And Dr. Vekil has started his talk with this innovation, which in a way was a shock for many people, because Mr. Trump is not a politician. He is a very good businessman. He has a lot of interest in women and in many other things. But is this a real innovation? Because I come from Italy, I don't know how deeply you are into Italian politics, but already 10 years ago, we elected and then we re-elected Mr. Berlusconi. And Mr. Berlusconi was not a politician. He also had an immense, believe me, immense interest in women, and I hope that Mr. Trump will not follow him. And they are already in the net, really going hand to hand, and there is a lot of affinity between these two gentlemen. So really was not a proper innovation. But I'm here to talk to you about innovation in cardiology, and in cardiology we have really millions of innovation. You already heard about all the innovation in stent, all the innovation for doing ablation, now with the cryoablation and so on. The innovation that we have in terms of imaging, it is really unbelievable, something which was unthinkable 2 or 3 years ago. So many innovation that I'm sure pretty soon there will be application to make the diagnosis. I could really treat a patient from India thanks to all these techniques which are really given the heart in front of us. Don't we? But I've been asked to talk specifically about the beta blockers in heart failure. And perhaps there is a lot of logic in this, because the beta blockers in heart failure not only were an innovation, I should say they were a revolution. Because when I graduated, I could have been taken into court if I would prescribe a beta blocker to my patients. Today, I can take into court if I don't. And it is quite important to see how all this develop, and it is also appropriate because we are talking about something which, believe it or not, was generated here in your country. Now, it's a very long roadmap. I am, this is not an innovation, but I am a computer virgin, and there is something here that does not allow me to go on. Perhaps I press the wrong button. Okay, thanks. Now, when I started medicine in 1960 and 1970, we were explaining heart failure with the back and forward theories. At that time, we had digitalis, diuretics, nothing else, and we were suggesting the patients to rest in bed. Then in the 80s, we started to be interested in inotropism. Do you remember? All this inotropic index, DPDT, DPDT max, and so on. And also we started to talk about pre and after load. As a consequence of this, we started to use positive inotropes and vasodilators. And there was a very stringent logic to do so, because we knew that there was a relationship between the ejection fraction, or the capacity of pumping of the heart, if you prefer, and the survival. The lower was the ejection fraction, the lower was the survival. So very logical, if I can increase with an inotropic agent the ejection fraction, I will also increase the survival. Very logic thinking. This, however, is the survival not of the patients, but of the clinical trial with positive inotropic agent. And you can see that none of this trial ended the period which was put forward. They were all stopped earlier because they were killing patients instead of increasing the survival. And that was quite a shock, because there was a lot of logic which didn't work at all in heart failure. And then in the 80s, we started to think about the so-called compensatory theory. And in the 80s, we started to think that the neuroendocrine activation was a compensatory mechanism. But even there, it was logical to think so, but even there, there were questions which should be asked, and which we did ask. And when I'm say we, it's a pool of colleagues, myself, Professor Harris from England, and Dr. Inda Anand from your country. And the question that we ask ourselves is, why should nature provide us, the human being, with a compensatory mechanism for heart failure? Nature is not so generous. Nature doesn't care about our disease. Nature provides adaptation mechanisms which are important for the survival of the species, not for a simple disease like heart failure. And that was really a very important question. And also, at that time, it was really difficult to know which was the real neuroendocrine response to heart failure, because all the patients coming with severe heart failure into our Western hospital, they were given by doctors a diuretic, a vasodilator, a positive inotropic agent, which all cause a neuroendocrine activation. And that is the very reason why we came here, in your country, and actually in the northern part of your country, in Punjab, at the PGI Institute. And by the way, at the PGI Institute, I saw the best medicine that I saw in my life. And what we did there, we studied not many, but some patients who arrive at the Institute in severe heart failure and who did never saw a doctor in their life. Therefore, they were not receiving any treatment. In these patients, we look for the hemodynamic. And you can see that the cardiac output, as you would expect, was reduced. The renal blood flow was reduced, so the GRF. There was an accumulation of sodium and water. They were in with the edema, or even some with the pulmonary edema. And there was something that was not at all affected, was the blood pressure. And that was quite curious. And then we did look the neuroendocrine activation or the hormones which were available at that time, like norepinephrine. And by the way, that was really an exercise, because as you know, norepinephrine is very difficult to be assay. We had to lyophilize the blood, send it to Italy, and so on. But we found it that there was an increase of noradrenaline and adrenaline, or the catecholamines, if you prefer, of the aldosterone and the antinaturated peptide. Very clear increase over the normal values, which are here. And then we did something else. We did look at the neuroendocrine response of a patient with a myocardial infarction. And some of these patients are coming to the hospital without having taken any drug. And that is in green. And also the neuroendocrine response to volunteer, like me, doing a strong exercise or given an injection of a vasodilator, nitroprusside, for being precise. And as you can see, the neuroendocrine response is exactly the same. So we started to think that neuroendocrine activation is not specific at all for heart failure. It is just a stereotype response evoked every time when the blood pressure is reduced, when the stroke volume is reduced. And there is reason for that, because it is essential for the mammalians, for the species to which we belong, to hunt and to reduce the bleeding during the hunting, isn't it? Therefore, it is useful for the survival of the species, and that is why nature has given us this response. So the problem in heart failure is that this response is particularly good during the hunting, for instance. But the hunting lasts a quarter of an hour, 1 hour, 2 hours. And the same neuroendocrine response is extremely useful to us every time that we have a strong stress. For instance, when you are driving, you have to brake because you are going to kill somebody. If you take your blood sample, you are in heart failure. If you do a strong exercise, or people who run the marathon, at the end of the marathon, they have the symptoms of heart failure, dyspnea. You take a blood sample, and they have the same neuroendocrine response. But the marathon lasts 2 or 3 hours. Then everything goes back to normal. In chronic heart failure, however, it is the heart that is not pumping, and is not pumping chronically. Therefore, the blood pressure is threatened chronically, and the neuroendocrine response is activated chronically, and that is what is bad. And once that we realized that, it was possible, a few years after, to think about the use of ACE inhibitor and also the use of the beta blockers in heart failure, which was completely contraindicated. And we started to do the research with the Swedish people, as you probably know. So everything was generated in reality in this country, because for any innovation, you need to have behind a very good, a very clear ideas. And in the 90s, heart failure becomes a neuroendocrine disease, and the evidence-based medicine invaded cardiology. We started to be more interested in prognosis than in symptoms, and we had big changes from vasodilators to ACE inhibitors, from positive inotropic agent to negative inotropic agent, which paradoxically in heart failure become positive inotropic agent. And I will tell you why. From resting in bed, now, in my hospital, we have a big heart failure clinic with a gymnasium, because we are sending the patients to training courses for doing exercise. Exactly the opposite. Complete revolution. Now, it is important to say that all of this results in good way of treating the patient with heart failure, because you can see the advantages in terms of reduction in mortality after the ACE inhibitor, the further advantages after the beta blockers, and also further advantages after the aldosterone inhibitors. And today, beta blocker therapy is a milestone in heart failure. And all the guidelines, whatever Americans, European, Canadian, they suggest to start as soon as possible with the beta blocker and an ACE inhibitor in your patients with heart failure. You will have a less remodeling, or you will have a less enlargement of the heart, which is very important. You will have less sudden death. And these are the newly released algorithmic from the European Society of Cardiology. And as you can see, you should start immediately the therapy with the ACE inhibitor and the beta blockers. If that is not enough to improve the ejection fraction, then you can consider an anti-aldosterone drug. And then here, there are a lot of innovation which I don't have time to talk about. But the ARNI is a very interesting innovation. This is an engineering put it together, drug with an ARB and an epilysin inhibitors. All the CRT and all the imaging innovation in before performing the CRT, because you don't have to put the catheter where it goes. You need to put the catheter exactly in the right position. And now we are talking about group of doctors and imaging doctors, which are extremely important to guide the electrophysiologist in where to put the catheter, because you need to avoid areas of scar or of fibrosis, and therefore you need magnetic resonance information, and you need to see which is the area with the most important delay in contraction, and that can be done by echocardiography. And if you use this technique, you will see that all your patients will respond tremendously to the CRT. And then ivabradine, another innovative drug, when it was discovered, these new receptors, new channels, which are located in the cells of the sinus node, and they are called the IF channels. So a lot of innovation. But just go back for a minute to the beta blockers. Well, why they are so important in heart failure? Because they reduce the heart rate, because they reduce sudden death, because they reduce the negative effect of catecholamines, and because they reduce remodeling and improve hemodynamic. These are data from the CB2 trial showing a drastic reduction of sudden death. These are important data showing to you the deleterious effect of a chronic increase of catecholamines on the myocyte. This is a human myocyte which has been exposed to high level of catecholamines. Look, from rectangular, it shrimps. It shrimps because it dies. This is a sort of rigor mortis. All the calcium which is in the sarcoplasmic reticulum comes up and put the myocyte into a massive contraction. And the diastolic pressure in the ventricle increase, and the stiffness of the ventricle increase. And the animals die much more. Look what is happening if you take rats which are overexpressing the beta adrenergic receptors. You can see the massive dilatation of the left ventricle, and again, less survival. But more revolution than this, I cannot put it to you. When you use a beta blocker, in the long run, what you do, you increase the ejection fraction of your patient. And that is something that is so important that we need also to explain why. Have you never thought why in heart failure beta blockers become positive inotropic agent? And I like to put to you the best possible positive inotropic agent. Why that? Because you see, the beta blockers, they are causing this positive inotropic effect for a particular reason, but at the same time, by reducing the heart rate, they reduce the oxygen consumption. What failed with the positive inotropes was that not only the positive inotrope increased contraction, but also they increase the need of oxygen, which in the patient with heart failure is reduced. Now, why are positive inotropic agent? Because of this scheme here, which is very important for you to follow. These are human papillary muscles taken by patients subjected to transplantation. And if you take the papillary muscle for the good area of the heart, and you increase the heart rate, and you look at the contraction, you can see that as you increase the heart rate, there is a clear increase in the contraction. If you, however, take the papillary muscle from the area which is failing, you can see that the curve is reversed. The more you increase the heart rate, the lower is the contraction. So when you use a beta blocker, because you reduce the heart rate from here to here, the net effect is an increase of ejection fraction. And that, sorry, I made the same mistake again. Sir, I need your help. I touched something. As I told you, I'm a computer virgin. Okay, so that is the reason why there is this increase in ejection fraction, which is so important for the prognosis of our patients. Beta blockers in heart failure are indicated always. They are indicated initially, they are indicated in patients with stabilized heart failure. If by any chance the doctor has not thought about using them, they are even indicated in acute heart failure. We are worried when there are recurrences and we are taking the patient into the hospital, and normally the first thing that cardiologists do, they stop the beta blocker. It should not be. You should just reduce the dose of beta blocker because they are always extremely good. No question, therefore, that they should be used. And no question, I'm sure that we are using them. But are we using them in the right way? Well, this is a survey that we did in Europe. And you can see that 90% of the European patients with heart failure are receiving a beta blocker. But out of this 97%, only 17% of them are receiving the beta blocker at the doses which has been shown in the clinical trials to improve prognosis. Now, this is really a big problem. And these are the reason why they are not used. For side effect, for inertia of the doctors, and so on. But it's really a big problem, because must be a real problem if everybody does not use the beta blockers as they should. And so the question is, should we go for the target dose, or perhaps should be better to go to the target effect? And we know which is the target effect, because we have to use the beta blocker at a concentration which allowed us to reduce the heart rate to 60 beats per minute. And this is very important. But it is very difficult. It is very difficult, particularly at the beginning of the treatment with the beta blocker, because the patients often, they don't feel very well. Actually, they feel worse. And therefore, you need to be very patient. You need to educate the patients to take this therapy. The guidelines does not recommend any beta blockers over the other. And the three main beta blockers which has been studied, as you know, are bisoprolol in CBIS, metoprolol in MERIT, and in Copernicus, carvedilol. And there are innovations in terms of beta blocker therapy? Yes. I think there are two innovations. The first one is a negative innovation, and that is that it is now clear that the beta blockers, very strangely, don't ask me why, they do not improve the prognosis of the patients with heart failure and atrial fibrillation. They are good to reduce the heart rhythm, to reduce the heart rate, but in patients with atrial fibrillation, there is no improvement of prognosis. And the other innovation is good, because now we have a third beta blocker, which is called nebivolol, which is important because it is highly selective for the beta 1 receptors, and on top of that, it is able to act at the level of the endothelium and to release a little bit of nitric oxide. By doing so, it causes vasodilatation, and that is very important at the beginning, at the starting of the therapy, because the patient will tolerate it well. Normally, nebivolol has been suggested and studied for hypertension, but there is a very important trial, which is the senior trial, to which I participated, And it is important because of this characteristic of the drug to be extremely well accepted by the patients. We target the real population of patients with heart failure, which is the people who are elderly. All the other trials has been done with the mean age of 60, but all the senior patients had an age of 70 and above. The results were very clear cut. There was a statistical significant reduction of the primary composite endpoint of cardiovascular death and hospitalization for heart failure. Not only that, but there are smaller studies looking at a head-to-head comparison between nebivolol, metoprolol, and carvedilol. And to make a long story short, nebivolol group experienced the 12 months cardiovascular events at lower rate than metoprolol and also than carvedilol. As you can see here, nebivolol came up as the best, followed by carvedilol and metoprolol. It's a small study, but provides some indication. And so I like to conclude with some clinical implication that nebivolol is the ideal beta blocker for the elderly patients. Improves outcome and hospitalization regardless of the ejection fraction. When tested against metoprolol, carvedilol, and nebivolol, was free from any side effect, therefore very well accepted by the patients and produced the best outcome. The superiority of nebivolol versus the other beta blockers, to me, is likely due to its effect on the endothelium and the enhanced nitric oxide release. And I believe that nebivolol should be the ideal beta blocker in elderly patients with heart failure and preserved ejection fraction, a particular condition which I don't have the time to talk with you, but which is becoming more and more common and in which we do not have any real targeted drug. Thank you very much for your attention.